We are a blessed people. Not everyone has this opportunity to learn openly about the Word of God. We've been looking at evangelism. We looked at the steps to begin evangelism and how it begins with prayer. And from there, we began getting more and more in depth. And we looked at how we can go about witnessing to other people. We looked at the Romans Road. We looked at Dave Krupp's method of reaching the lost, the steps that he suggested to take. We saw from all the methods, including listening to Ray Comfort, that before someone can receive Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, that first they must realize that they are lost. Because unless we realize we have a need, we'll never realize that we need a solution to the situation. And then last week we began looking at Roman Catholics, and are they really saved? Are they really Christian? Find the right page. Last week we began looking at Roman Catholics, and we saw, and we don't have to do any real study to discover this, but how many of us knew that Roman Catholicism, or Catholics, are a large part of the religious people of the world, or at least, quote-unquote, Christian, so to speak? I mean, we don't have to go far. There are a lot of Catholics in our area. Of course, you have your different version of variations. What makes them different, I couldn't tell you, but you have the Roman Catholics, you have the Russian Orthodox Catholics, you have the Greek Catholics, and the list goes on and on and on. Irish Catholics. We looked at stats, old stats, stating that almost 1 billion people are Catholic, or were Catholic, that there was a huge Catholic movement, not of God. They have their own charismatic movement, which means that there are Catholics that speak in tongues. We talked about that as well. I know in Sunday school we talk about it a lot. I use that phrase a lot. But regardless, we discussed how I said it was somebody we knew had come in common that knew Sister Beth and I. I think she told me about it from a book, actually, that somebody wanted to check out these tongue-speaking Catholics, and when they got the language got closer, they discovered that they weren't praising God, but rather they were praising the devil. You know, the devil's out to deceive a lot of people, and he knows his time is coming to close, so he has to work quickly. Now, before we go any farther, let me just say this. Is there a possibility that there might be a saved Roman Catholic or a Catholic that has a real relationship with God?
Yeah.
Yes. We cannot rule that out in every denomination. Just because the religion might not be of God does not mean that that individual somehow came to have a relationship with God. Now, if they allow the Holy Ghost to deal with them, they will get out of that religion, if they're sensitive enough, but just because they are in there does not mean that they aren't saved. There is always that possibility. So for us to go bashing the Baptist or go bashing this religion or that religion, there might actually be somebody in there that has a true relationship with God. Not everyone is bad. It's like taking a true or false test. Whenever that question had that word all in there, you knew it was false because more than likely because it didn't hold true for everything in that category. But a few years ago, we went through a back to basics course. Why did we do that? To know what we believe and why we believe it. We look at and study other religions. That way, we know how to confront them. We know where they're coming from. We know their viewpoint. We are also living in a very, very dangerous time. When we look at the time frame in which we're living, we see that the plan of God's ages for time itself is rapidly coming to a close. We see the book of Revelation rapidly approaching. The more that we live, the more we see the push towards the cashless society. The more that we live, we see the push towards the one world government. And there's going to be one other push that comes along with that. Can anyone tell me what that one is going to be? One world religion. And here within the last year or two, we had several big heads of religions, different religions getting together, claiming that there should be one world religion. But that is not the case, because there is only one true gospel, and that is of Jesus Christ. And we are to be promoting that gospel. We ought to be telling others about Christ. When it comes to high-profile evangelicals, they promoted the idea that Roman Catholicism is definitely within the boundaries of biblical salvation. Billy Graham, to name one, he reports that when he started out, we would have no contact with the Roman Catholics, and they did not have any with us. Now, all denominations join this meeting and follow-up classes for converts are sometimes held in Catholic parishes. Dave Hunt quotes Billy Graham as saying, "I found that my beliefs are essentially the same as those of Orthodox Roman Catholics." Graham calls the Pope the world's greatest evangelist and says that any differences in their theology are not important as far as personal salvation is concerned. He announced that we're delighted that the Roman Catholic Church now cooperates with us wherever we go. That cooperation involved about 400 Catholic quote-unquote counselors at one of his crusades. Charles de Lua, a Jesuit and Vatican official, assures Catholics attending Graham's crusades, "A Catholic will hear no slighting of his church's teachings authority. His church's teaching authority, nor of papal or episcopal prerogative, no word against mass or sacraments or Catholic practices." W.A. Criswell, former president of the Southern Baptist Convention, stated, "I don't know any more dedicated to their great fundamental doctrines of Christianity than the Catholics." If this is so, then why was the Reformation necessary? Why were all those martyrs for the truth of God's word? Just a rebuttal statement for him. Paul Crouch, he belongs to TBN. "I'm eradicating the word Protestant even out of my vocabulary. I'm not protesting anything. It's time for Catholics and non-Catholics to come together as one in the Spirit and one in the Lord." Robert Schuller, some would recognize the Crystal Cathedral and the Hour of Power, "It's time for Protestants to go with the Shepherd." And he's referring to the Pope. "And say, what we have to do come home." What do we have to do to come home? Pat Robertson, a signer of the Joint Declaration, "Evangelists, Evangelicals, and Catholics Together," in which we're all asked to finally accept each other as Christians. Chuck Colson, a signer of the ECT, which the Evangelical and Catholic Together Act, or whatever you want, declaration, whatever you want to call it, were urged to stop aggressively proselytizing each other as Christians. John White, president of Geneva College and former president of the National Association of Evangelicals, called it a triumphal moment when the ECT, or Evangelical Catholic Together Declaration, was signed. It was a pact between evangelicals and Protestants. When we go back to Martin Luther, as I was already proclaiming, what was Martin Luther's big problem with the Catholic Church? Well, it was works, but when we get down to the basis and broad spectrum of it, the big argument is, why did Martin Luther start the Reformation? Did he start to create his own religion? Yada, yada, yada. Was he the spark? And we can go on and on and on. But Martin Luther's big criticism, if you ever read any of his works or study church history, there is nothing pompous about him, Brother Dennis, that he wanted to start his own religion. Martin Luther did not get up one day and say, I'm going to go out and create Lutheranism. I'm going to get my own cult. We're going to live here. We're going to live in a castle. You know, they'll give me all their money, all their possessions. No, that was not his big gripe. His big gripe was the Catholic Church wasn't following the Bible to the T. They were doing what they wanted in some areas and teaching it as doctrine or part of the faith, when in actuality, he was against the Word of God. In fact, his famous statement, I think it was at the, I'm not even going to mention Catholics because there have been so many in church history, but his famous statement is, here I stand. You know, this is where we are. He could not stand on any other fact but this. If it doesn't line up with the Word of God, then it's not biblical. We need to stop doing it. That was Martin Luther's whole gripe. Was he just wanted the Catholic Church to follow the Bible. When we look at the churches, the Christian Church, the Catholic Church, the Evangelicals, the Protestants, which church is Christ's church? If you start actually studying out Catholic Church history and start reading some of their literature, according to Reverend John O'Brien in The Faith of Millions, he stated that the Catholic Church themselves state this: the Catholic Church is the one true church established by Jesus Christ for the salvation of all mankind. The Roman Catholic Catechism book instructs Catholics, saying, if you belong to the Lutheran Church, your church was founded by Martin Luther in the 1500s. If you belong to the Pentecostal Church, your church was founded in the early 1900s. But if you belong to the Catholic Church, your church was founded by Jesus Christ and it was the first and oldest Christian church. Is the Catholic Church, do their beliefs line up with our beliefs? Are they really Christian at all? Do they follow the same Bible to the T that we follow? Well, in order to have a comparison, we have to have something to judge it by. And yes, I did say that word, judge, even though people will like to argue, Moses, do not judge. We have to have something to judge it by. So, when it comes to us at the end of our life, the standard is not going to be the world or how far we live from it, but the standard is going to be Jesus Christ. You can be a good person all you want, but if you do not line up to Jesus Christ, you might hear the words, depart from me, thou work of iniquity. I never knew. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the standard. When it comes to quote-unquote religion, when it comes to Christianity, when it comes to this Christian walk, what do we have in this life to go by? We have the Bible. So is the Catholic Church really Christian? Well, what was the early Christian church like? One of the very first things we'll find when we look at the early Catholic Church was that they preached repentance. Would someone please find Luke chapter 13, 3 and 5. Luke 13, 3 and 5. And if someone else would like to find John 3, 7 and hold that. John 3, 7. So unless you repent, if we're going to witness to people, we have to break down these words. What does repent mean?
Forgiveness.
It means forgiveness. It's a little bit more than forgiveness as well. It's a confessing of your sins. It's a saying, I'm sorry. It's not the receiving the forgiveness act, but rather it's a recognition that you have sin in your life, you have fault, and that you're going to confess it, that you're going to say you're sorry. So the early church preached repentance, acknowledging that we are sinful, acknowledging that we have sinned, and accepting Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. That's where it all begins. We have to realize that we are a sinner, we are lost, and we have to confess our sins. So the early church preached repentance. They also preached a new birth. If someone has John chapter 3 and verse 7, John 3, 7.
Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again.
Ye must be born again. We know that Nicodemus marveled. He didn't understand it. You know, it's a dying to the old self and being born again spiritually, starting anew. So they preached a new birth. In Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, you don't have to turn there, but we see that they laid hands on the sick, they saw signs, they saw wonders. Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 8 is the lame man that was at the gate, beautiful. And when we find him laying there, he's somebody that everybody knew. There's no denying that this man was lame, and he's been lame for many, many moons. And Peter and John were going to the temple, and what did they say? Exactly. They laid hands on the sick and they recovered. They saw signs. They saw wonders. They saw miracles. Side note, things with signs and wonders and miracles, they are the validity of the truth of the Christian gospel. They are the truth that we have the real deal. We also know that when it came to the early church, they worshiped loudly. So loudly, especially on Pentecost, that they drew crowds. We know according to Acts chapter 2 and the book of Acts in general that they spoke with, good thing I didn't give you the notes yet. They spoke with our tongues. They spoke with other tongues. They prophesied. They interpreted. They exercised the gifts of the Spirit. And not just some, but they exercised all the gifts of the Spirit. We know that they cast out demons. The chapter is eluding me right now, but the seven sons of Sceva, we know that the demons knew Jesus. They knew Paul. So they cast out demons. We also know that in Acts chapter 15, that Paul grew tired of that demon-possessed fortune-telling girl following him day in and day out, mocking him. Until finally one time he just cast out the demon and it came out within the hour. So we know that the early church cast out demons. When we look at the sermons of the early church, who was at the very center of the sermons of the Apostle Peter and John and James? Who do you think was at the very center of their gospel? Jesus. It wasn't Mary. It wasn't St. Andrew. It wasn't St. Bartholomew. Although they can pray to St. Andrew all they want, I still haven't found my $3 million to quit work. But Jesus Christ was at the very center of the gospel. Paul said, I preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified and resurrected. Jesus Christ was at the very center of their sermon. In fact, get this. The early sermons did not ever include Mary. They never included idolatry. In fact, they preached against idolatry. They had bonfires and burned idols. They didn't worship them. When we look at the early church, not only did they preach repentance, but what comes with repentance? The assurance that when you confess your sins, Jesus is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. They preach an assurance of salvation. Not one of these that you have to go day to day wondering if you're saved, but you can have an assurance right now that if you died, you'd go to heaven. and they preached that salvation was through Jesus Christ alone. You know, there's a lot of people that claim to be good people out there that are hoping to get in heaven. But the early church preached against that. They said that good works will never do you any good. But rather, what did Paul write in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9? Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. So the early church preached that your assurance of salvation was around Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. By grace are you saved. There's nothing else that you could have done to save yourself. Even if you would have been crucified on that tree in Christ's body, you could have never saved yourself anyway. Because it's not of works. You were born into sin. You needed a sinless sacrifice. And it doesn't matter what you do in this lifetime. It doesn't matter what good you do. It doesn't matter if you give all your money to the poor and live in a cardboard hut underneath the bridge. It doesn't matter what you do. You can't do anything to obtain your salvation. It is through Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Good works, Mary, or anything else you try to do, will never save an individual, according to the early church. That is still Bible today. And when we look at the early church, the Apostle Peter, Paul, James, never once do we have them even hinting at or writing about the idea of purgatory, penance, repetition of prayers to gain merit, praying for the dead, rosary beads, confessing your sins to a priest.
Or
try praying them into heaven. Or paying to light a candle to get around the purgatory. When I was in Bible school, I was out of ministry with my roommate, and we were off in another state, and he was preaching, and he was in a role about the rich man Lazarus. And he was preaching how Lazarus was trapped in this flame, and he was reaching out for the poor. Reflipping theology and putting it back in corrective perspective. The rich man was stuck in the flame, and he was reaching out for Abraham to send Lazarus to go and tell his brethren about Christ. And he concluded his message with, "And that's why we believe in purgatory." And I'm sitting there, "Kyle, we don't believe in purgatory. That was paradise, but we don't believe in purgatory." The Bible does not anywhere mention purgatory. It doesn't even hold a candle to anything about purgatory. In fact, we'll probably mention it again, but on a side note, a lot of the off-the-wall Catholic doctrines don't come from the Bible, but it comes from a portion a book called, it's a collection of books, but what's known as the Apocrypha. A lot of their off-the-wall ideas come directly from that. Praying to the dead. Idea of purgatory. And also, before we continue on, the repetition of prayers, that's a heathen practice. That's for them praying to their gods. That's not for us Christians. We were instructed not to pray in vain. We don't need to do repetition of prayers like the heathen do. Is it okay to pray prayers over and over? It is. But it makes a difference when you're there, "I don't know, give me $1 million, give me $1 million, give me $1 million, God, give me $1 million," versus an actual, "God, this person needs a healing touch," and you go back day after day after day. There's something that is completely different. But it's the heathen that pray repetitious prayers, hoping for an answer. It's not the Christians. So when we start looking at the Roman Catholic Church, and we'll not go too far in depth, we only have 5 minutes left, but when we look at the Roman Catholic Church, We know a little bit about them without diving in deep into their doctrine or going in depth at this point. We know that they are one of the largest religions in the world. They are also one of the wealthiest religions in the world. They have literally millions and millions and millions of dollars. If you've ever gone overseas and seen the cathedrals, they're huge, they're splendorous, there's lots of money that was put into them. If you look at St. Peter's Basilica, it is a huge facility worth billions and millions of dollars, I'm sure. It's vast, it's grand, has a huge old obelisk out front. Think of all the architecture involved, the statues. Think of all the land they own. When we look at the Roman Catholic Church, they're the only religion in, regardless, they have their own country. They are a religion that have their entire own little country called Vatican City. They have their own leader, the Pope, who also serves probably as acting president. They have their own military, their own banks, they have their own post offices. And the list goes on and on. They are recognized as their own little country. It has its own military, its own police. It has its own police, its own employees. On top of whatever land they own and buildings, they have a grand amount of treasures, ancient documents, things that are kept in storage because they are that valuable. Artwork. I mean, the list goes on and on. They have their own chapels. It is ruled by the Pope. He is referred to as the Bishop of Rome, the Vicar of Christ, who is also goes along with that title as successor of the Apostle Peter, because they believe that Peter was the very first Pope. They claim that the Pope is thus charged by Jesus Christ to head his earthly church because he is known as a successor to Peter. In the 1970s, the Catholic Church announced that not all masses had to be recited in Latin. Catholics did not have to eat fish on Fridays anymore. The nuns modernized their habits, and certain saints were then demoted. But they also claimed that the Catholic Church never really changed. It changed some of its traditions, but it never changed its major doctrines. Going back to the 1970s, we then see a split in Catholicism versus we have then the modernized Catholics, and we have the old Roman Orthodox Church, which just, when they were going on about not all masses had to be held a Catholic, you find that the Reformed Catholics will have it in the common tongue, whereas the Orthodox will still have it in the masses in Latin. But if you actually get down and study the doctrines of the Catholic Church today, the doctrines that they hold today are the same ones that they held to in 1545. So they might have modernized a little, but their doctrines are still the same. Their beliefs are still the same. And now that we know and we're firm in what we know what we believe. Now we're ready to take on what does that person believe and how can we lead them to Christ? You know, what perspective are they coming through? Because the Catholics are going to have different eyes when it comes to salvation and how to obtain it. And we'll talk about this later, I'm sure. But you know what the big hurdle for Catholics is? They cannot get past the fact that salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ. They think that they have to do something. Well, I have to do this. I have to go through this with works. I know I was talking to an older woman I work with. She is Catholic. And no matter, and we can talk about, we don't really talk about Christ, but we know we're religious. She knows I go to church and I know she's Catholic. But every time I talk to her about salvation, the hurdle that she always comes back to and keeps reiterating is that it's through works.